you tell us a few things just about what the company does and your role in the company?
Sure, yeah. So it's our 10th anniversary this year, so it's quite exciting thinking about the history of the company. It seems crazy that we're 10 years old. So we're a translation company, and we provide translation services mostly for businesses rather than private individuals. So when a company is looking to move overseas and needs to translate its website or some of its marketing materials, then really that's where we come in. My role as operations director is to make sure that the processes throughout the business actually work smoothly. Translation is quite interesting. It's not like having a factory where you're making something that's either right or wrong. There's a lot of subjectivity about it, and the only way from an operational perspective that you can be sure the business is working and you're doing good work is to have really solid processes. So really that's my job, to oversee that throughout the company.
When Christian started the business back in 2004, now 10 years ago, did he envisage it as a global company then? The sort of company that we think of as a born global company?
I don't think so. When I joined, there were four other members of staff, and everybody was working from home, and 90 to 95% of the customers at the time were based in the UK. It was really only when we realised just how competitive the industry was and just how many opportunities there were beyond the UK boundaries that we started to think, well, actually we can start to do a bit better looking overseas sometimes.
So it was a few years before you actually branched out.
Well, the first thing we did to branch out was to try to stop our staff having to work late nights. And from that perspective, Christian went to New Zealand for 3 months and found a couple of people who could work for us overnight. And that was really where we understood just how relatively easy it was to set up in other countries if you just went there and had a go, basically. Yeah.
So that gives you a 24-hour-a-day
well,
service.
Certainly UK plus New Zealand was the quickest and easiest way to do that in the first place.
New Zealand, of course, is an English-speaking environment, and English we think of as a global language.
Mm.
And I know people tend to think, well, if English is becoming universal, why does the world need a translation service? And in fact, translation services are very valid. Why does it continue to be necessary to have translation services?
It's a very, very good question. I think lots of people do speak English, and even people for whom English is not their first language use it very comfortably in a business and everyday environment. The internet really has a lot to do with the proliferation of other languages and the importance of other languages. So we talk quite a lot about what we call the foreign language internet, and by that we mean the vast array of sites and websites that aren't in English, and some interesting research done within the industry that shows that people are far more likely to buy something from a website in their own language, even if they speak other languages just as well. People search online initially in their own language. So when you look at statistics, you can see that, for instance, the number of Arabic websites or Russian websites is increasing far, far more quickly than the number of English websites. So I think the internet is actually the primary driver behind English not maintaining a complete foothold and taking over as the only language required.
So the technology has facilitated local adaptation of websites.
That's right,
yeah.
Yes.
But also those languages which are thought of as minority languages, I suppose, in global terms, to some extent they're catch-up, aren't they? Because they're addressed to audiences where there's a much lower percentage of the population who actually have internet access. I mean, it's still quite low in the Middle East.
That's right. I think this is where translation becomes more and more valid and will continue to grow. As I said, I think the internet is the key driver behind this. So as we see Arabic speaking countries or China or places throughout India, for example, where there's huge populations, more and more people getting online, then I think that's where we see other languages becoming more important, almost in tandem with the business opportunity in those countries and those languages.
machine translation seems to be improving by leaps and bounds. Does this present a challenge to Lingo24? And if it is, does the company feel that it can meet that challenge and survive despite improving machine translation?
Yes, very, very interesting one, that. Machine translation is improving dramatically, and by machine translation we think normally of something like Google Translate that we see people see all day every day when you're on the internet. It is getting better, but the way we see it is that machine translation is ideal for people to be able to translate things that perhaps they wouldn't otherwise have translated. So in this age of Web 2.0 or Web 3.0, as people have started talking about now, you have a massive amount of user-generated content, comments on social media, people creating their own fan pages, people creating their own user guides. Well, actually, for those, they wouldn't normally be translated, so machine translation is a good way to make those more accessible. I also feel machine translation is very powerful for helping the first stage of translation. So, for instance, let's say as a company you set up in France, which might be bold because you might not have anyone who speaks French. Well, if someone sends you an inquiry in French, step one, Google Translate, see what they're asking, and if you need to do more than understand that and send a reply back, then you can use that as the platform for doing more. You can often get a really good gist as well from machine translation, and sometimes you can use it as a basis for human editing to get to a certain predefined, albeit slightly lower end quality standard, but for some things, you know, you don't have to be perfect, you just need to be good enough. So
it's a complementary service to your specialist service.
I think that's right. I can't see a situation within at least the next 5 to 10 years where machine translation will be sophisticated enough to take on the likes of marketing, creative marketing translations or creative writing. That's really, really a long way off. But for maybe translations of content that's been carefully authored in a controlled way, using limited sets of language or particularly technical, rigid language, then actually machine translation does have a complementary and actually very powerful role to play already.
Is it difficult to recruit good translators?
Yes and no. There are vast numbers of people who think they're a translator. The most common thing when someone asks me what I do, their most common response is, "Oh, I know someone who speaks French." Well, that's all well and good, but to be a professional translator is a very specific and quite challenging skill. So again, with the internet, it's very easy to find people who think they are translators. The real challenge is to filter those people based on A, what they tell you, and B, what you can actually tell from looking into their references and making them do tests as well. So that's the first stage, and then really once they start working, it's a case of just building up the trust and people showing what they can do in real scenarios when there's under some time pressure perhaps, or with commercially sensitive material.
And then you get feedback from your clients.
That's right, and from other translators. So as you build up the circle of trust, as it were, of translators who you know can do a good job, a translator who's very trusted maybe is checking the work of a newer translator, and gradually you build up the pool of people who really can do a good
and
reliable job.
These are self-employed people, aren't they? They're paid by the job, by you. Is that how it works?
That's right, yes. Yeah. So the vast majority of translation companies like us work exclusively with, or almost exclusively with, freelance translators dotted all around the world. Usually you want to use people who are based in the country where the translation is destined for, because even if you speak several languages very well, you lose touch moving out of the country where the language is native.
What would you say is the key behind the success of Lingo24?
One of the things has been that we always said yes, and I think that's something that I think is the key to any growing business. You have to say yes first, and then be able to think and work quickly to fulfil the yes, which can be a little bit scary sometimes. But that's the sort of attitude and culture that everyone in the business, not just the managers, but everyone who works in a business that's trying to grow, needs. So a yes attitude is definitely one. I think also our willingness to to try and think about things from first principles.
Mm-hmm.
None of us in the business really had that much business experience, but we felt we were intelligent enough to be able to think, well, what's actually the correct way in which it should be done? So we don't necessarily do things in the normal way, but we think we found good ways of doing things that work for us. And it has meant that we've tried to find business opportunities in perhaps unpredictable places.
Yes, one of the things that businesses have found in recent years is that it's been difficult to bring in new business because of the financial crisis and recession, which is, it's not been global, but it's been in a lot of markets. But Lingo24 has actually been expanding in this time, hasn't it?
The global financial crisis actually helped us in a slightly complex way, which I think I can explain. what we found happened with us is that our percentage of business from non-UK customers grew quite significantly during the financial crisis. So around about 2008, the value of the pound went down quite
mm-hmm.
significantly. What that meant is we could reduce our prices to customers who were paying in euros and paying in dollars, whilst actually when we converted that back into pounds, it was worth more to us.
Mm-hmm.
So our customers got a good deal, and we got a good deal, and we significantly increased our customers overseas. So it was a case of seeing an opportunity actually in the crisis. British businesses didn't have so much money to spend, and while businesses in the Eurozone and paying in dollars perhaps also didn't have as much money to spend, we could make it cheaper for them without receiving less money for ourselves. I think I explained that reasonably coherently. Yes.
I mean, you have expanded globally, and some of your locations might strike one as unusual. For example, the Philippines you're going to, and Romania. Can you explain a bit why you've chosen those locations?
Sure. So we started off only being based in the UK, and we wanted some time zone operations, so we went to New Zealand. But then New Zealand is quite expensive, the UK is quite expensive, so we thought, okay, we want to find locations where we can expand our staff numbers quickly, where they've got good language skills, where there's perhaps not so much competition for the really good graduates, and where we're in the right sort of location for understanding our target markets. So that's really how Romania came about in the first place, which was our first major non-UK operation, where we now have something like, I think, 100 employees in Romania. So then we used the same principles to find somewhere in the US time zone, and we shortlisted Costa Rica and Panama, and not me, unfortunately, but Christian, my fellow director, went over there to suss the places out on the ground. And Panama was ideal, with good language skills, good experience speaking English in a professional context, and not that much competition within our sector. And now in the Philippines, the same principle, with really fitting together the final part of the 24-hour jigsaw. And we wanted somewhere in the region that perhaps was less predictable than Hong Kong or Singapore, where everybody goes. So we found ourselves in a city called Cebu City, which is the second city of the Philippines. And I haven't heard of it before, but it's a thriving city. Cebu's a thriving city with a massive call center business serving US companies. So
because there are English speaking people in the Philippines.
The English is outstanding. I've really been doing telephone interviews with potential staff out there. I've been amazed by how good the English
good
is.
They
speak English all day, well actually all night, because they're working the night shift serving the US companies. So it's going to be easy for us, or it has been easy for us, to appeal to people, because they can work during, we want people working during the day rather than overnight.
You've grown considerably, you've become a kind of global company. I wonder if you're thinking about where you go organisationally from here. You're a private company, I assume. Are you thinking of going public at any time?
It's very difficult in what is really is still a fairly small business to decide what happens next. And our strategy really is just to run the company as well as we possibly can, on the basis that either that means if we ever want to step away but we still own the company, we can, and it works and it doesn't rely on us, or if someone else were to be interested, then they can see it's a properly functioning company that doesn't rely on on a small handful of owners and directors. So really, that's a it's a slightly sort of generalised strategy.
Mm.
But again, if we did decide we wanted to go public, then you know the company needs to be in really good shape for that,
mm.
And all the reporting requirements. So.
Mm.
Yeah, for the time being, the strategy is just to do things as well and as tidily and as effectively as we possibly can.
And it's and efficiency and cost effectiveness is one has been one of your selling points, hasn't it, from the client's point of view?
That's right. Well, when we started off, all our staff worked from home, and now we do have office locations, but there's very much a cost consciousness throughout the organisation, which means that we try to be clever in how we do things, not invest vast amounts of money in expensive software when there's a huge amount of really good free software out there that one can use and adapt, which means that our clients can get a good deal without compromising on the competence of the company us that they're engaging with.
I wonder if you've got some advice that you might give for people thinking of starting up their businesses now, based on what you've learned through working with Christian as your co-director.
I would say think outside the box, which is a massive cliche, but it's really true. Don't get too stuck into ways that you're told to do things. Use that as the bedrock, but take your own ideas and think, does this seem like a good idea? And if it does seem like a good idea to you, and you can't find a reason why it's not, go for it. There's a lot you can do quite cheaply to experiment with ideas. Even trying to set up in a new country doesn't need to cost very much at all, whether it's translating a couple of pages of a website or just going to a few conferences in that country for a few days. Just take a few gentle risks, but don't take any big risks. I don't think you need to take big risks to experiment.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.